Harper Audio presents The Copernicus Legacy, The Golden Vendetta by Tony Abbott, performed by MacLeod Andrews. Chapter 1. London, England, April 2nd, 9:42 a.m. Wade Kaplan squinted toward the end of the long hallway. His lungs ached. The air was chilly down there, almost refrigerated. He counted the cold fluorescent bulbs ranged along the low ceiling. 12. They cast a pale white light on the inside walls, on his family, his stepbrother Darrell, his father, Roel, his stepmother, Sarah, and on the tall man in the navy blue suit who stood facing them.
Behind me is the steel-reinforced titanium entry door to the vaults, the navy blue man said. Each portal is equipped with multi-layer encryption combinations that are refreshed at random. We are, in a word, unbreachable. Follow me, please. Bring your item.
The man, whose name Wade hadn't heard clearly, was head of vault security at the British Museum in London. He spun around neatly on his heels and walked down the corridor.
This is it, Darrell whispered. The official end of the London episode.
I hope so, Wade said. They paused at the end of the hall.
After the man entered a key card, a thumbprint scan, and a voice command, 579428, Wade heard a series of electronic bolts releasing, followed by a whoosh as the heavy door opened. They passed through to the other side, where two armed security officers stood guard. Once inside, they heard a similar series of reboltings as the door closed, and they were among the warren of underground vaults.
The vault level of the British Museum is among the most secure in Britain, the man explained. In the world, actually. Your box will be safe here.
The box Wade's stepmother now held, an unassuming steel container the size of a large hardcover, housed Crux, a mechanical cross crafted of amber, inside of which was some manner of mysterious and heavy internal mechanism. Crux was one of 12 relics that powered the time machine of Nicolaus Copernicus.
We're nearly there, Darrell said in his ear. You can start breathing now.
Not yet.
You really should. In, out. In, out. It helps with the whole being alive thing. I find it useful to begin breathing almost as soon as I wake up in the morning. The day turns out so much better. There have been studies.
I'll bet there have, said Wade.
Boys, said Sarah. They continued to the end of another blank corridor, which, the navy-suited man told them, parallels Great Russell Street, running some 20 feet above us. He helpfully pointed up. It seemed to Wade that he'd been holding his breath for the last week, or actually the last 3 weeks, for it was in early March that they'd first learned of the 12 mysterious parts of Copernicus's time-traveling astrolabe and gotten swept into the global search for them. They had battled the deadly agents of the infamous Teutonic Order of Ancient Prussia and their leader, Galina Krause, and had rather amazingly discovered two of the relics so far. The first was a heavy blue stone called Vela, currently stored at the Morgan Library and Museum in New York. Crux, the second, would be temporarily housed here in sub-vault 17 of the British Museum.
Too many things aren't right, Wade whispered as they entered the final room through yet another thick steel door.
The room was empty except for a metal table and a chair and a safe built into the rear wall.
This here is right, said Darrell. Yeah, but not Becca.
Becca Moore was currently recovering at Great Ormond Street Hospital. If, Wade thought, you could ever quite recover from what had happened to her. Becca had traveled through time. Sort of. The previous week, Becca had had episodes, like visions, that shot her back in time, in her mind, if not her body, to the 16th century. It was her weird coiling paths back and forth in time that had allowed them to find Crux and thwart their dark pursuer, Marcus Wolfe, Galina's assassin. But it had cost her. Not only had Becca learned a terrible truth, that traveling in time opened the door to horrible catastrophes, but through the whole adventure she had suffered blinding headaches and nosebleeds. She was finally too exhausted to see Crux to its new home.
Yeah, and not Lily either, Darrell admitted.
Lily Kaplan, Wade's cousin, was supposed to have met her father at Heathrow last week. He was going to bring her home. They had all expected him. Then, at the last minute, he'd canceled his flight. Lily's parents were going through a rough patch, as Wade's stepmother put it. Very rough, it turned out. And it wasn't a patch so much as a plain old ugly divorce. Lily had become depressed and quiet, so unlike her, and was at that moment at Great Ormond Street, keeping Becca company in her hospital room. The past week had been an ordeal for everyone, but especially for the two girls. The navy blue man positioned himself in front of an alphanumeric keypad on the wall next to the safe door, where he input a long series of numbers and letters. Then, he pressed his thumb to the scanner and entered a metal key. Wade, Darrell, and their parents had examined Crux extensively, but hadn't found any clues to the next relic. Each relic was known to hint at where the next one might be found. But technically, they had located Crux out of order. It was Serpens, the relic Galina Krause had stolen from them in Russia, that would show where the very next relic lay hidden. Even so, they'd taken dozens of photographs and x-rays of the Amber Cross. They'd study them until Crux, too, gave up its secret. The safe door opened slowly. Any last words? Asked the navy blue man. He beamed a distant but confident smile. Wade's father glanced at them all, then shook his head. It will be good knowing it's housed here. Sarah placed the box into the safe. The man carefully turned the key, which had remained in the lock. The safe door clicked closed. Another few seconds of inputting into the keypad, rescanning his thumb and removing the key, and the relic was secure. Wade breathed. In, out.
Well then, there you are, said the navy blue man. There is 24-hour camera surveillance, and there are temperature scanners on every inch of the vault level, including each room.
He pointed vaguely to several lenses and grills recessed into the ceiling.
30 guards patrol the vault system at all times. You are fortunate to have the influence of the Ackroyd Foundation, a major benefactor of the museum.
Terence Ackroyd and his son, Julian, had become their close friends and essential team members in the relic hunt. After the Kaplans and the Moors boarded their flight back to the States that evening, they would enter a kind of private witness protection program designed to keep the order from finding them. They would, Terence told them, effectively vanish from sight. Until, that is, they had to begin searching for the next relic. As the man in the navy blue suit led them away from sub-vault 17, Wade hoped Crux would be safe there. But something told him that nothing was really safe. Not anymore.
Chapter 2. Olsztyn, Poland, April 3rd, 11:43 p.m. The sky was a black shroud prickled with a smattering of stars, a slow-rising crescent moon and a clearness that seemed to spread to the far reaches of the universe. Galina Krause, the dark-haired 19-year-old leader of the Teutonic Order, looked up to the heavens, and the valves in her heart fluttered.
A hole in the sky, she said.
10 feet behind her, shivering in his thin coat, the pasty, bent astrophysicist Ebner von Braun raised his face from his phone.
Yes, Galina, you said?
Magister Copernicus uses those words just prior to the astrolabe's first entry into the flow of time. He writes of witnessing a hole in the sky.
Pain trembled from her throat to her chest, her arms.
What shall we make of it, Ebner?
5 servers at the Copernicus room in Madrid are specifically dedicated to his riddles, this one in particular. Better now, perhaps, to focus on the business at hand. the plane will appear over the castle in 7 minutes.
Despite the streetlights and spotlights surrounding it, Olsten Castle rose up, a medieval darkness against the greater dark of the sky. Galina walked up a steep path toward its walls. Construction on the castle had been begun by the Teutonic Knights in 1347. Of greater interest to Galina was that at various times from 1516 to 1521, Nicolaus Copernicus lived and worked inside its walls. This was a matter of historical record. There was, moreover, a fresco of his astronomical research still visible in his rooms along the northeast wall of the castle. What was not generally known, however, was that precisely during the years of his residence there, the astronomer began dispersing not only the relics of his time-traveling astrolabe, but the machine's larger framework. From these, Galina hoped to gather clues about the remaining relics. Her goal? To attach them to Kronos III, the most successful of the Order's own time machines. According to a cryptic fragment in a recently located letter, one major section of Copernicus's Eternity machine was buried beneath Olsten Castle's walls. And so, naturally, they required a plane. Ebner scurried up to her.
It is approaching.
He took from his overcoat a box and drew out its long antenna.
Delectable that something so compact can fly a 1,600-kilogram airplane with a twitch of a lever. The pilot will certainly be surprised when all instrument control is lost. Interestingly, besides being an expendable junior operative of ours, the pilot is...
Do not tell me, Galina said.
He swallowed.
No, of course, no.
Footsteps sounded. She turned. It was Marcus Wolfe, just arrived from London. He approached the castle like a pilgrim to a shrine, and yet he was not so much a pilgrim as a spy waiting to be debriefed.
Tell me about Crux, she said.
There was never small talk between them.
A mechanical cross encrusted in amber. The Kaplans located it in a church crypt. It was transferred yesterday to a vault in the British Museum. Herr von Braun claims to have a man on the inside.
I do indeed, said Ebner. Do not doubt it.
We shall see, said Galina.
As it happens, Wolf continued, in 1517 Copernicus passed Crux to the martyr Thomas More. On his death, the relic went to his daughter, and finally to his daughter's friend, or sister, as she was called. You will want this back.
From the inside pocket of his leather overcoat, he produced a small golden locket. Taking it from his gloved hand, Galina felt her palm go cold. Inside was a portrait of the sister, Joan Elaine. Mesmerizing. Sorrowful. Galina closed the miniature and pocketed it.
Her crypt?
Was a terminus of time change. The girl, Rebecca Moore, was deeply involved. There is a problem with removing the children just yet. I saw this.
He drew out his phone, swiped the screen. The image was hazy, taken from a distance at night, showing a church tower, a shattered window, a blur caught in haste. Still, what Galina spied in the glimmer of crisscrossing flashlights and spotlights was unmistakable. A bronze disc inlaid with colored glass in a flower pattern. It hung from the belt of one of the children inside the tower, one whose face was in shadow. She had seen the item before.
The rose window?
A Westminster Abbey, Wolf said. A trinket from their gift shop. It is one of four purchased for the children by your former captive, Sarah Kaplan.
Which of the children is this? Asked Ebner, hovering over the phone.
It was dark, Wolf said. One of the boys.
One of the boys.
Galina turned away from both men. The sky was blacker still.
So he or one of the others will lose the trinket in the ruins of Albrecht's castle at Königsberg.
Wolf tilted his head slightly. Perhaps he.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.